Hi, this is Marlene Gibb with What Do You Do? And today's guest is Phil Sokoloff. And do you want to tell us what you do?
Yes, well, I work as a publicist locally for the Sierra Madre Playhouse. And
okay.
And as well as a number of other nonprofit arts organizations around the city.
All right. So let's talk about how you got into this.
Well, I was producing theatrical shows back in late 80s, early 90s, and having been an English major, I would write my own press releases,
okay.
And the actors in my show saw that I was able to get media coverage for my shows, so they started referring me to other theater companies, and so I built up a practice whereby I would do press and media relations for, first for stage and later for motion pictures.
Oh, really? So now you're mainly in, let's talk about your background.
Mm-hmm.
So how did you get into motion pictures too?
There was a playwright I knew who started, a boutique cinema house in Hollywood, and he also started releasing motion pictures as a distributor. And I started working with him. His house is called the Arena Cine Lounge. That's on 6464 Sunset Boulevard in Hollywood. And they do independent and genre films, many of them that you won't see anywhere else in the city. And so I started working there about 4 years ago. I've been with the Sierra Madre Playhouse, I think, since about 2004.
Wow.
So I've been with them a long time. But I've been doing publicity for the theater for 24 years now.
For the Sierra Madre Theater?
Well, since 2004, that'd be 14 years for Sierra Madre,
but
24 years throughout the city.
Wow.
And Sierra Madre does shows year-round.
Right.
And since we're in the San Gabriel Valley area, I want to talk about them specifically. Our spring show is The Immigrant, which opens April 20th and is running through May 26th. It is the story of a Jewish immigrant fleeing the pogroms in Russia who came to Hamilton County, Texas in the year 1909, where he was befriended by an older Christian couple. And it's the story of how he made a life there and his friendship with these Gentiles in the Texas community. It's directed by Simon Levy, who's an award-winning director who had recently directed The Chosen at the Fountain Theater in Hollywood.
That's getting really good reviews.
It's gotten really good reviews. And The Immigrant is an interesting story, primarily because it's true.
It's based on a book, isn't it?
It was based on a book, but then it became a play, and then it became a musical. But we're doing the non-musical play version. But it's a true story. It's the story of the writer's grandfather, who, as I say, moved to Texas and lived to be 100 years old. We have a number of events in the community which are designed to promote the play. We're on the last Sunday in April, which would be the 29th, we're having a panel discussion about immigration issues. This is in conjunction with the Southern California branch of the ACLU, and we'll have three immigration experts. That'll be at 1 o'clock on Sunday, April 29. That's a free event.
Is that at the Sierra Madre?
It's at the Sierra Madre Playhouse, and that's free.
Okay.
The Sierra Madre Playhouse is at 87 West Sierra Madre Boulevard in Sierra Madre. That is just east of Baldwin Avenue at Auburn Street in Sierra Madre. Ample free parking until midnight.
Mm-hmm.
There are several dining options just steps away from the theater. Free parking is an issue for a lot of theater goers. So it's a safe neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can park your car and see the show and have a nice meal beforehand, and it's kind of like a one stop. But it's a beautiful old building from 1923, beautifully maintained and restored.
Mm-hmm, right. What was it in 1923? Do you know?
I believe it might have been a vaudeville house, and it, at one point during its life, it was a movie house. We still have the original marquee with new neon, but yeah, the house is it's 90 been there for 95 years. So, and we're right next door to an excellent Thai restaurant.
Uh-huh.
And there's a Greek restaurant across the street, which is also excellent.
Yeah, they have good food, right?
Yes. And so The Immigrants, our next show, as I say, we have a number of free events connected with it. We're going to have a...
Is this going to all be at the theater?
Yeah, well...
Or outside the theater, not in the theater itself.
But. Well, the immigration panel will be inside the theater.
Okay.
We're also going to have a klezmer concert in May. That'll be one Thursday night in May. We'll have a group called Mostly Klezmer. Mostly Kosher, excuse me. Mostly Kosher is the name of the group, I'm sorry. Yeah, Klezmer is Yiddish music. It's the European Jewish music. It's the Jewish blues, essentially. The word Klezmer comes from a word meaning to play. It differs from American blues in that rather than the guitar, the central instrument are woodwinds.
Okay.
The sound is very reminiscent in some respects of American blues. But this sounds a little bit different. And Mostly Kosher. I'll get their name right sooner or later.
Mostly Kosher. Okay.
They also have a fusion of their music with klezmer and Latin music and American blues and a little bit of rock and some folk music. Although it's mostly kosher, so it's mostly Jewish music. So they're going to be there at Sierra Madre for one Thursday in May.
We'll have this on the screen.
Yes, and there'll be ticketing for our events is at sierramadreplayhouse.org. The phone number for people who don't like to use the computer is 626-355-4318.
Okay.
And yes, what we try to do for every show we put on is that to have public events that are associated with the play. Some of them are free.
Mm-hmm.
The next big show we'll be doing after The Immigrant will be in the summer, and that will be opening in June 22nd. That will be Pump Boys and Dinettes, which is a country pop musical. It's kind of nostalgic, but it's lots of fun. It's a musical that has not been done in the Los Angeles area in 30 years.
I've never heard of it.
I saw the original production 30 years ago when it was played in L.A., and it's just a load of fun. If you like, pop music and country music, and, it's a little bit of rock and roll in there, too. As the title indicates, it's about a service station and a diner somewhere on an American highway, and it's about the people who work there, and the songs are just fun. It's just mainly designed to be fun. We have a wonderful director by the name of Alison Bibikoff, who is very well known in the theatrical community for directing musicals. She's also a choreographer. And the musical director who's leading the band is Sean Paxton, who has been in a number of shows at the Sierra Madre Playhouse. So that'll be our big summer entertainment. And coming in the fall, I believe, let me see the date. Yeah, opening September 7th, we have the Gin Game, which is a Pulitzer Prize winning show about two seniors, an older and a man and woman, and obviously they play gin. And we have Alan Blumenfeld, who is currently starring in The Chosen at the Fountain Theater,
okay.
And he'll be playing the man, and the woman will be played by Catherine James, who starred as Amanda in the Sierra Madre Playhouse's production of The Glass Menagerie not long ago. And so that will be opening September 7th, and it'll be directed by our company's artistic director, Christian Lobano. And then, to wrap up the year, we'll have a Christmas show We don't have the title quite wrapped up yet, but that'll be coming in November. In February of 2019, well, we're getting a little ahead of ourselves, but that's okay. Every February and March, we pick a show that is aimed at families so that you can bring your really young children there. So we're doing The Adventures of Stuart Little, which is based on a famous book by E.B. White. Right. E.B. White also wrote Charlotte's Web.
I love Charlotte's Web.
And he was the editor of the New Yorker magazine for many years as well.
Really?
Yes, he was. So we have Gary Lamb coming in to direct. Gary directed Charlotte's Web at the Playhouse 2 years ago. So he'll be back. And to direct The Adventures of Stuart Little, who is, you know, he's... it's about a mouse who is trying to survive in a people's world of people. So that'll be in February and March, and that'll be... Adults can enjoy it too, but, you know, you'll be able to bring your young kids there.
Let me ask you, what do you... Sierra Madre has changed over the years. I mean, with the plays they're bringing in. And why do you think that is?
Well, under our current regime...
Right.
Under our artistic directorship by Christian Lobano, and our managing director is Estelle Campbell, we are focusing now exclusively on American writers.
So they chose American writers.
We chose American writers, because Sierra Madre is, if you've ever been there, if you go there,
I've gone to the theater. Yeah,
it's very much this kind of Norman Rockwell like little village, and it's. It kind of screams Americana at you, although actually the people who live there are quite diverse, more and more so as the years go by. I mean, as I say, you walk down the street and there's a Greek restaurant and a Thai restaurant, and there's a French cafe. So you got a mix of cultures there, but the look of the place is still kind of mid-century Americana.
Exactly.
So, we decided to, I think partly just to have a focus, to focus on one group of playwrights and do them really, really well. And so that's been, our artistic objectives.
And then you have the reading group on, Monday nights, that when people
yes.
come in and read their plays?
The last Monday of every month, we have a free reading series called Off the Page, where we get professional actors to do stage readings of plays, some of which are being considered for full production. But this has been a very popular people attend. We have very good audiences for this. But it's a free event, so the price is right. As I say, they're not fully produced. They're readings. Actors will have some actors will have scripts in hand. This is a way for you to get to hear how a theatrical work sounds.
Okay.
And
in the rough, right?
Well, yeah, but still, it's a rehearsed reading, so that it will be somewhat polished. And if the response of the audience for a particular script is exceptionally positive, we'll produce it. We'll give it a full production. Which is like The Gin Game is an example. We read that. I think we read The Immigrant a couple of years ago, and we brought it back for full production. So it gives an idea of what our audience wants, which is an intelligent way for a theater company to go about it.
I don't know. Like you're talking about Sierra Madre as Americana. If you were somewhere in LA, you may get a completely different audience, right? Or do you get just people who like going to plays?
Well, our particular audience is from around the surrounding communities,
right.
Pasadena, Monrovia, Sierra Madre, Arcadia, Altadena, Duarte, for the most part. In the days before we became more focused, it was mostly an older Caucasian audience. In the last few years since we've started doing American plays, we have a more diverse audience. We recently did Nothing is the Same, which was about some Hawaiian kids at the time of Pearl Harbor. And we had, and all our actors were Asian Pacific. And we had many people in the audience from the Asian Pacific community attending this particular show. We also did Anna in the Tropics, which had a Latino cast. A few years ago, we did The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, and we had an African-American actor in the lead. So, we pull in a diverse audience because we try to cast our plays with people who look like people from our surrounding communities. When we did the Odd Couple, there are a pair of, for example, there are a pair of sisters whom the two guys invite up to their apartment to entertain. Yeah. We cast them with Asian actors.
I remember that. I saw that.
Right. And so we'll do... And when we did A Christmas Story, we had one of the kids was a young Asian actor. And we did The Dream on Royal Street, which is a musical set in New Orleans, and we had a diverse cast there. So Los Angeles is becoming... We're in the Los Angeles vicinity, and Los Angeles is becoming more and more the international city. You know, yeah. 90 different languages are spoken by kids in the L.A.
Really,
the Unified School District, yes, at home, you know. So our casting is going to reflect that to the degree that it's possible.
You don't do the Pasadena Playhouse, right?
No, I don't handle the Pasadena Playhouse.
I know, speaking about the diversity, I was there a couple weeks ago, months ago, and they did Our Town, mm-hmm. and they did it all in signing. Was all done in signing, and I mean, it took me about 5 minutes. I thought, gee, they're doing this and this. Why are they doing it? And then I realized they're signing.
Yeah.
So yeah, that was really good.
Yeah, Sierra Madre also did Our Town a few years ago. It's a very popular place by Thornton Wilder. Our artistic director Christian Lovano played the lead, which was called the stage manager.
Right.
And speaking of American classics, Christian will be directing next spring. He'll be directing *The Great Gatsby*, which is adapted. The script is by Simon Levy,
who does a lot of scripts. Simon Levy.
Yeah, he's directing *The Immigrant* for us, but he's adapted the script for *The Great Gatsby* with the approval of the F. Scott Fitzgerald Estate.
So, oh, you have to have this. Is that where you had to get the approval?
Well, he did. Fitzgerald's been...
gone a long time.
He's been gone a long time, and he might have been gone long enough for his material to be in the public domain, but Simon... Well, I think it's not a brand new script. I think it's been done, but it hasn't been done locally lately. But Simon did go... to the trouble of getting approval from the Fitzgerald Estate for his adaptation. So we're doing that in the spring of 2019, and Christian will direct. But yeah, in addition to the events, special public events that we have associated with each play.
Well, you had, what's his name, Fritz...
Fritz Coleman, yes. Yeah, we've had him here.
Yeah, I went to that.
Yeah, he's been to the...
I went to that one.
Playwright, the Playhouse a number of times. He's also a comedian, and he does and a memoirist, and he does his one person shows at the Playhouse from time to time. And we do bring in you know, special event shows. But in addition to our main stage shows, we always have and there's a nice, very nice lady by the name of Diane Siegel who curates a lobby exhibit to go with each show. So you'll see. Artifacts and memorabilia themed to each show that's coming in. So it gives the audience a more environmental experience when they come to see shows at Sierra Madre.
When you thought of all this, I mean, this is a lot, because I know the whole environmental feel when you're in the lobby.
Yes.
You guys worked on it really hard.
Yeah.
To get this whole, and because it's a small theater, it's 99 seats.
It's 99 seats, exactly.
And, but you have that whole feel of it. It's very close. Everything's very close.
Yes, yes. There's not a bad seat in the house.
No, there's not a bad seat in the house.
Yeah, the it's a proscenium stage that's raised so that nobody's head will be in front of you.
Right. So when you do this, do you think of all these things, I mean, with the outside, beside just the demographics of the people, but everything else that's included with doing a play? Who does your scenery? Are those all volunteers?
No, not necessarily.
And the clothing and?
We do bring in the professionals.
Okay.
In most cases, I'd say, we bring in professionals. Since Christian has taken over the artistic directorship of the theater, we've upped our game artistically and in terms of the professionalism of the presentation. It's a professional theater. I mean...
Let's talk about... So Sierra Madre is professional theater, and then some of the smaller theaters around, where do they fall? I'm not talking about the San Gabriel Valley, because there's maybe 10 theaters in the San Gabriel Valley, outside the San Gabriel Valley.
Well, there are...
You cover 20 theaters. That's why I...
Not necessarily at the same time.
I know.
But the
feel for each theater is different.
Yeah.
I mean, the Glendale Center Theater is a lot different than the Sierra Madre Playhouse.
Yeah. There are a few theaters in town. Well, most theaters in town are professional. They adhere to union regulations and standards. There are a few theaters which are in town, which are community theaters, which are basically made up with neighborhood volunteers or students. The production values might not be the same, the performance values might not be the same, and you might not be charged as much. The Sierra Madre Playhouse is elected to go in the direction of using professional actors and professional designers.
Now, do they pay, but don't they just get scale? I mean, or do they, you know, I don't know how the money is between the non-professional and professional. In the 99 theaters, I thought they did it differently.
Yeah, there is, the union rules changed us in the last couple of years for the 99 seat theater, so we're currently working under a union contract.
Okay.
The designers negotiate with the theater their salaries. I don't know specifically what they get paid, but the immigrant is done under a union contract, so they're getting whatever the union...
And Patsy Cline was done under a union contract.
I believe so, yes.
Yeah.
And we're bringing back the actress who played Patsy Cline,
Tall lady.
Yeah, the one who played Captain Patsy Cline.
Yeah, yeah.
Is Corey Cable Kidder, and she is going to be one of the lead performers in Pump Boys and Dinettes, which is our summer musical. So we're bringing her back. She was very popular, and she was nominated for an Ovation Award, which is LA's equivalent of the Tony Award, but she was nominated for an Ovation Award for best performance by a female actor in a musical.
Did she perform in Orange County too?
I don't know.
My son saw it in Orange County, and I don't know who would play, but he said he enjoyed it in Orange County. So some of these plays, do they travel around from one theater to the other theater? I know Patsy Cline did.
Well, different theaters to make put on the show. They're not necessarily touring productions.
Okay.
I know Sierra Madre, I do not believe, tours with its shows. Although some of the actors may work in multiple theaters.
But you probably have a lot of the same actors, right, from what you're saying?
Occasionally. I mean, not necessarily, but occasionally.
Okay.
I know we did, our summer musical last year was The Marvelous Wonderettes, which is a 1950s musical.
Yeah. And that was good.
There was a later production of that play in Los Angeles, in North Hollywood, and some of the same actors, a few of the actors, were in both productions. But it wasn't, it's not a Troon production per se, it wasn't our production.
Do you think, I mean, how many theaters are there in the L.A. area?
Golly.
I mean, there's so many. And how many, since I'm just asking off the top of my head because you know more about this stuff, do people outside the San Gabriel Valley go to a lot of things in, like, Burbank or downtown? Or do they stay more in the San Gabriel Valley?
It varies. I think it depends partly on the project.
Yeah.
One of the first things I think that Christian Lobano was associated with when he came to the theater was we produced the play Arcadia by Tom Stoppard, and it's a Pulitzer Prize winning play. And we drew an audience from across Los Angeles, I guess because some of our actors were fairly well known and well regarded. So people would come to see specific performers. When we do the Gin Game this fall, I imagine we're going to get some of the same people who saw The Chosen in Hollywood, because they're going to come to see Alan Blumenfeld.
I've never been to the Fountain Theater, but I'm going to be going to the Fountain Theater. Is that a 99?
Yes, it is.
Okay, and that's in East Hollywood.
Yeah, East Hollywood, yeah. And it has its own parking lot. I've seen stuff there.
Okay.
It's a very good, it has a wonderful reputation.
Well, they do a lot of avant-garde stuff too, don't they?
I really don't know their entire
okay
their programming thing, but I've seen individual plays there. Simon Levy, who is directing The Immigrant for us, has been the artistic director at the Fountain Theater for the last 25 years.
That's a long time.
Yes.
Yeah. Where do you see theater going here in L.A.?
Well, I believe that we have to create theater for the changing demographic of the city. When I first came here, it was mostly a white audience, and the demographics of Los Angeles have changed. So I think we have to diversify our programming to reflect the composition of the population of Los Angeles.
Right. My neighbor was Nobu McCarthy.
Yes, and she was...
And she played in The Karate Kid. She played mm-hmm. his girlfriend. And Mako, he's, but my girlfriend is Filipino. And I went down to, it's near Little Tokyo. It's the East-West Theater.
East-West Players, yes. I worked on a show there this past fall.
Okay, I went to see the Criers. It was a Filipino mm-hmm. Play. It was very good. And, yeah. And they use it an old church.
Yes, they're a mid-sized theater. They're about 300 seats.
Yeah, yeah.
And there are a lot of wonderful little Asian restaurants right in the immediate area, yeah. And they have parking right there, which is very good. And I worked on a show there recently called Yohen. That was with the Roby Theater Company, co-produced it with the East-West Players. The Roby Theater is a black company. I've worked with them since 2001. And the East-West Players have been there for a very long time. They started out in Hollywood and moved there. And Nobu McCarthy did the original production of Yohen 20 years ago. She's passed away since then.
She was my neighbor.
Yeah, and June Angela and Danny Glover did the play recently there. So, yeah.
Did you see the play?
Yes.
How was that play?
It was wonderful. It was a wonderful show. And they do wonderful work there. So.
Okay, so if people are interested, I do like Theater. Yeah. If people are interested, how do they keep track of all this, what's playing? I mean, because you know 20, but I mean, there must be 100 theaters in
yes, LA. Well, you know, one place to look at, you go to latimes.com, and on Fridays, they have a section called the 99-seat beat, and they profile four different shows that are opening around town each week. So they point you in the direction of shows that may be of interest. And in the San Gabriel Valley area, there's a section of the Pasadena Star News on Fridays and Sundays called Spotlight. And that's also a very good place to look to see what's playing in the immediate San Gabriel Valley area. Also, the Pasadena Weekly does feature articles about worthy shows in the area of Pasadena and Glendale in particular, and the surrounding San Gabriel Valley communities.
Did you always like plays when you were a kid, growing up in Philadelphia?
Yeah, well, the first play I saw as a kid was a Western. It was called The Mystery of Outlaw Canyon. I remember it's, you know, 60 years later. Yeah, it made an impression. There was a fair amount of theater back then. Of course, it was only an hour and a half away from New York, which of course is like the sort of like the live theater capital of America.
Exactly.
Now, New York is a different model than Los Angeles. New York has a concentration of theaters in one theater district. In Los Angeles, you have smaller theaters in every neighborhood. And quite frankly, I think we're better off for having theater in every neighborhood.
Yeah, some of us don't want to go drive that far. I have to tell you something, because we're both from Pennsylvania. But I remember my mom said that when they used to take the plays out, like to the smaller towns, like Scranton.
Yeah.
If it didn't make it in Scranton, it didn't make it, she would say.
Ha!
She told me that. She said they'd come into Scranton to see how it was going to be, and if they didn't like it, they didn't perform.
Yeah, pre-Broadway tryout. They did that. Yeah. Some shows went through Philadelphia for the same reason.
You got Philadelphia for the same reason?
Yeah, pre-Broadway tryouts.
And if they didn't make it?
Yeah.
Do we have something like that in L.A.?
I don't think so, but I think in San Francisco, it sometimes uses a tryout city.
Okay.
I know there are a number of shows which started here and became big hits in New York. Children of a Lesser God started out here. There was one, there was some rock and roll film, Rock of Ages, started out in a small theater in L.A., and then it went to Broadway and then became a movie. But it started out in a 99-seat house in L.A. Children of a Lesser God started out the Mark Taper Forum, and then it went to Broadway, and then it became a movie.
Really? The other one that I went to was Caltech.
Yeah.
They have plays.
Yeah.
And for my birthday's in December, I got to see Patrick Stewart doing a one-man show 4 years in a row of A Christmas Carol.
Yes, and he's done that on Broadway as well.
Oh, that was just absolutely... I mean, his memory. And you knew when he was switching, and he had nothing. He just had the chair and a table. Mm. And he just, with his voice, you knew which character he was in.
That's why he makes the big Hollywood paycheck.
Yeah. He's a Shakespearean actor,
yes,
too. So that was exciting for me to see. I just wonder if, are children being exposed to theater?
Well, you know, as I mentioned, every February and March, we try to do something that has a special appeal for the kids.
Right, but that's February and March. Are all theaters trying to do special things for kids, little ones?
No, there are a few theaters that are. There's Theater West in Hollywood does kid stuff, especially for ages 3 to 9, from September through June. They take off in July and August because the kids are out from school, they're on vacation. So they sort of plan that around the school year when the kids will be in town. And really from September through perhaps July, they'll do a show there on Saturday afternoon. Now, in the Sierra Madre show in February and March, we also bring in busloads of kids from schools to the theater.
Oh, so what do you have in the afternoons?
Well, whenever they can be scheduled. Okay. You know, we work out with the individual school, but you know, we have field trips of school kids coming in to see our shows. So we actually do those shows for thousands of kids every year.
That's good. Now tell me about your background. I'm very curious about your background and how you got into this whole passion, because you sound like an encyclopedia to me of everything that's going on. Tell me, I know you grew up in Philadelphia, so.
Yeah, and I studied theater at the Hedgerow Theater School, which has been there for, I guess, close to 100 years, or, well, yeah. I think they've been around for about 80 years, actually. And they're on the, what they call the main line of Philadelphia, mm-hmm. in that area, in the suburban Philadelphia. They've been around for a very long time. And they started out with a commune of actors who actually lived on the premises. That was unusual for the time. And it was started by a group of actors who were in New York. They were a company called the Provincetown Players. And they moved to the Hedgerow, which is in Media, Pennsylvania, just outside of Philadelphia. And I went to school there, and I also studied acting at Temple University. And from there, I went to New York, and I did some plays there. And then I came out here, and I did a bunch more. I appeared as an actor in about 70 plays on both coasts.
Did you like being an actor, or do you like being a publicist, or you like it all?
Well, I like it all, but you know, being an actor is not steady employment. So.
Right. It's up and down.
And as a publicist, I work all year round, so.
But you niched it. I mean, you...
I did.
I mean, you could have done all kinds of writing, but you niched this.
I did. Well, there seemed to be a need for it. You know, as I mentioned, I majored in English, so I knew how to write an intelligent press release.
Well, that's very
good.
But
also, I kept myself affordable so that all these nonprofit companies could afford to hire me. And I work hard, so.
How many press releases? You do a press release. Now, are you doing anything with on the web? Are they?
Yeah.
Okay.
I do lots of stuff.
So you're familiar with... doing?
Yeah, I have to do stuff on websites. I have to plant stuffs all over the web. You know, there are theater-related websites and also general websites. I send stuff to the LA Times and the LA Weekly, as well as theater-centric sites like Performing Arts Live and ICE, Better Lemons, which are theatrically oriented.
I'm on the Sierra Madre Playhouse mailing list, so I get things there, and I know what's going on.
Uh-huh.
I go to the website if I want to see the play and look it over.
Yes, that's great.
Yeah, I do. I'll check it out and see will I like this one or not, but. I just don't know the audience. We have an older audience who likes plays. You said it's in its very, we have multiculturalism here.
To a degree, but you know, I mean,
most. It's reaching the audience.
Most of our audience is a little more mature, and we program with that in mind. You know, the exception is our February March show.
With the children.
Which is more family oriented. And even with those, we pick something a younger audience would like, but also that their parents would be able to tolerate. You know, that's the question that the Sierra Madre Playhouse and actually any theater company should be asking is, when they contemplate producing a play, is who's the audience for this show? And you identify who your audience is now.
Well, some people may just like that they want to do it because they like the play, but they don't know if other people would like that play.
Well, that's very risky. That's a very risky proposition.
Yeah.
Because somebody has to buy the tickets in the end.
Yeah, and Sierra Madre's tickets are about $30, right? About anywhere around between $30 and $40.
Yeah, I think for the our general admission ticket for the immigrant is $40, and but there are students and senior tickets which are lower price. I think the ranges depending on your age, it ranges from 25 to 40.
Yeah, and that seems like the going rate around here.
And it's also a union production, so we have to pay salaries. So that's part of the equation as well. But like the Amundsen, for example, downtown, which is a larger theater, will charge anywhere between 65 and 90.
Oh, yeah.
So even or more for a more elaborate production. So
well, the Mark Tapers is about $60-some too, I think.
Right. So so is the Pasadena Playhouse, although they do have special, you know, Pasadena resident nights, which are a cheaper ticket. You know, there are, you can find discounts if you look for them. You know, I'm a senior, I take advantage of senior discounts.
Right, right.
And most theaters offer them. But, you know.
Well, the seniors like to go to matinees, too.
That's also true.
You know, they'd rather go out in the afternoon.
That's true to a large degree. I mean, you know, we have a Sunday matinee at the Playhouse, and it's especially convenient if we want to do a special event like our immigration panel on the 29th. And
now that's going to be inside the theater?
That's going to be inside the theater. Yeah,
okay.
Inside the theater. Yeah.
Okay.
Most of our special events are inside the theater. We are a few exceptions. For we had when we did the Hawaiian show earlier this year, we had a hula in the street on the side street beside the theater. We had a hula show. But that's an exception rather than the rule. Most of our special events are inside the theater.
Okay. Well, this has been a very, very interesting conversation.
Well, before we close, I just want to repeat the address and
okay, content. You can repeat the address.
Thank
I
you
know,
very much.
I know this. I know Sierra Madre is your big one right now.
Sierra,
right?
Well, yeah, Sierra, you know,
because we're here.
Since we're in the San Gabriel Valley, Sierra Madre Playhouse is my
baby.
My main baby and the main theater I work with here. Sierra Madre Playhouse is at 87 West Sierra Madre Boulevard at the corner of Auburn Street. That is in the city of Sierra Madre, 91024. There is ample free parking behind the theater. Mm-hmm. And the phone number for tickets...
Right behind the theater.
Right behind the theater, yes.
Right behind the theater.
Our phone number for tickets is 626-355-4318. And our online ticketing is www.sierramadreplayhouse.org. And our current show is The Immigrant from April 20 through May 20 and 26.
Okay. Thank you very much. And if anybody wants to contact you, do you want to give out your number if somebody wants to contact you?
Well, I think if it's about the Sierra Madre Playhouse...
You want the Sierra Madre...
They should contact Sierra Madre Playhouse directly. I think that's the thing to do.
Okay, thank you. And thank you for being on the show.
Thank you.
This is Marlene Gibb with What Do You Do?